This morning, our focus is on joy. Actually, it was rather impressive because I've been having this Choose Joy as a little devotion book, which has been very helpful. And joy is something that has been part of my life for a long time because I realised that the joy in the Lord rather than joy in the circumstances often gets us through many issues in life. But one of the nights that I was awake and not sleeping, I thought, okay, what gives you joy? What gives me joy? So I had a look around and I had a think. And one of the things that gives me a great joy is gardening. So the seeds that I plant that don't always come up, but it's always good to have a plant that comes. And I think Nathan's got a photo of one of my plants, a little plant there. And I think just the fact that they come through the ground and they progress to grow. And then one of the greatest joys was when my granddaughter, who's only five, said to me, "Grandma, that's a beetroot plant." And I thought, wowzers, she's actually learning about gardening already. So that was my little joy. One of the joys is the gardening. Okay, and I then thought, what's another joy that I really have a great deal of joy about? And that's the smile of a baby, especially a child or a grandchild. Now, I'm not a baby goo goo gaga sort of person, but when I had grandchildren coming into my life, just the capture of the eyes and the recognition that they have with you and you have with them, that gives a great deal of joy to my heart, and I'm sure it gives a great deal of joy to your hearts. And then another thing that I thought of was the gentle touch of a loved one that penetrates the skin on skin, the inner feeling, the inner being, whether it's a partner, a husband, a child, a parent. It's just beautiful to sort of know that you have that inner connection, and the realization of the joy of the Lord is your strength. And I firmly believe that we have a lot of strength coming from the Lord when we trust in Him. So we're going to open with a song, "The Joy of the Lord." You might not know it, but the words are there. You can read along or you can sing along. Thank you.
Thank you.
let us pray as we move into this service. Thank you, Father, for the many blessings that you give to us. Thank you that we can worship you and praise your name. Thank you, Father, for the joy that comes from you, comes through you. And Lord, we pray that we will rely on your strength, that we will not try and do things in our own strength. And thank you, Lord, for the inner strength that you give to us. You make it available to us, and we need to accept it and use it, and especially to use it to glorify your name. And Lord, we pray that this morning's service we might hear and actively hear the words that can help us to be glorifying your name and to be used by you and to just represent Christ to this world. We pray these things in your name. Amen. We're now going to have our announcements, and I believe Tony and or Nathan will fill us all in because we've got a few things that we need to deal with.
Thanks, Janet. So first of all, the October quarterly business meeting is going to be held this Thursday, the 21st of October at 7:30 p.m. and that'll be over Zoom. So please see, there's a link in the bulletin there for the agenda and associated documents. As well, I'm sure most of you are probably aware that there's been a lot of changes in our state over the past week in terms of restrictions and announcements being made in that area. And so with the state now reaching 80% fully vaccinated adult population, and in line with the Baptist Association recommendations, the in-person services can now resume from next Sunday, the 24th of October. Now, this means that with the current public health order, both vaccinated and unvaccinated people are able to attend church in person, and that's not going to be checked on entry. But it is back to the 4 square meter rules. So we're looking at having a maximum of 66 people in the auditorium. You'll still need to check in, wear masks, and there'll be no singing in the congregation for the time being. So if for some reason, well, which we may certainly do, is reach capacity in the auditorium, we can have the other rooms available, like downstairs, to help spread people out. But in the bulletin, I've put a little quick survey there, just so that we might be able to gauge, who's planning coming back straight away, who's still, potentially waiting to see how things change. We're still going to be having the services on Zoom every week for the foreseeable future. So if you could just let us know what your plans are, what you're comfortable with. We certainly don't want to pressure anyone into something that they're not comfortable with. So, but if you could help us, let us know so we could plan around that and have the availability there to manage services as they come back. And I'd ask that you'd obviously be patient with us as we, get the gears of running a service at the church going again. It's so we're very grateful for everyone's patience and compassion in that situation. Yeah. Also, with those restrictions changing, that the deacons have moved that the annual general meeting will be held on Sunday, the 7th of November, at 11 a.m. after our morning service. And at this stage, it'll be held on at church and also online over Zoom. So with this date now announced, with nominations for deacons and ministry coordinator positions have reopened. Nominations that have already been made earlier in the year will still stand. So nominations for deacons would close next Sunday, being 2 weeks before the meeting, and nominations for ministry coordinator positions will close prior to the meeting. There's also links on the bulletin there to see what nominations have been made already and who and what positions are without a nomination. Also, I'd like to give an update on we've been engaged the deacons and elders in a church consultancy with members of the association's church health team. And so we've had a number of meetings to date with the team, and they've provided very helpful advice to us as a to help us make some decisions there now. So just be in prayer for that process, and pray that it will lead TBC to continue to grow as a healthy church. And we're very grateful for all the support and prayers that that you have. All right, might pass it on to Nathan if there's any other announcements there. No?
Only that Jenny Ann's doing the music roster again. So if you're somebody that wants to be able to sing, we're allowed to have 10 singers up on the stage as of next week. So if you can't sing in the congregation and you really want to sing, just let Jenny Ann know, and she or we'll set up some extra microphones and you can just go up the front and sing along and just hold a microphone. So we don't have to turn it up.
Yes, there's a few more announcements in the bulletin, so as always, be checking that for all the information. Thanks.
And please let us know if you're not able to access the bulletin, and we might be able to work out a way that we can give you some of that information, because it's important that we all stay informed and we know what's happening. We're just going to pause now, and as a reminder of the offerings that we normally give, our gifts and offerings, at the moment are all done online. I'm not sure what will happen, Nathan. Someone will fill us in next week. But let's just pray for the gifts that have been given to the Lord's work. So let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you do provide all that we need and that we're able to give a contribution back to you. It's a free will gift, Lord, and it's a gift of thanksgiving. And so we pray, Lord, that we will think carefully about your work and the needs, and that we can consider the offerings that we can bring before you, that these will be used within the community and in the extended areas. We thank you for the opportunity. In your name we pray. Amen. Kevin is going to give us our Old Testament Bible reading. So, Kevin Sweeney, thank you. You'll just have to unmute yourself.
I'm there, Jen. So our reading this morning is from Psalm 28, reading from verse 6 through to the end. And these words are in accordance with the New International Version. Praise be to the Lord, for he has heard my cry for mercy. The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him, and I am helped. My heart leaps for joy, and I will give thanks to him in song. The Lord is the strength of his people, a fortress of salvation for his anointed ones. Save your people and bless your inheritance. Be their shepherd and carry them forever. May God give to us an understanding and an insight into his word this morning.
Thank you, Kevin. After that reading, I had a think about what we could do to join together to praise and worship God. And so I've chosen just a very simple old song that is fairly repetitive, but help us to focus on the Lord. Our God is an awesome God. Thanks, Nathan.
Oh,
Dean is now going to bring us together in prayer. Thank you, Anne.
Let's all come before our Father in prayer. Our Father in heaven, your name is holy. You are the creator and sustainer of this world. And we, your children, gather together to praise and worship you. We thank you for the beauty you have given us, the lake, the wonderful birds, flowers and trees, the sun by day and the moon by night. We thank you for sending your Son to die for us on the cross so that our sins are forgiven and that you raised him from the dead so that we can serve a living Saviour and Lord and have a relationship with you. Father, we live in a world today that is in turmoil. COVID, volcanoes, damaging storms, wars, and people who have chosen not to follow you and who seek each day to go against your godly behaviour. We pray that you will guide and help us as we bring your love, compassion, and healing to this world. Lord, for your children serving on the mission field overseas and in Australia, we pray. We bring Phil and Lisa to you and ask that Outback Patrol might be able to start up again soon. Father, we continue to pray for our state and federal leaders that they may make wise decisions. We pray for the people of our community that they might turn to you. And we thank you that we have been able to serve you in our community, especially with those at Toronto High School. And we ask that that service will be able to continue. We continue to bring Chris and Amy to you with their health problems and pray your protection on them. Thank you that you've brought Pastor Peter and Michelle to us at the moment. We pray that you will guide Peter in his interactions with us and as he shares your word with us today. Please give him your wisdom and strength. Father, we pray for the leadership of the church and for protection, patience, and wisdom. We pray for the QBM next week and our annual meeting to be held in November. Father, we know that there are some in our church family who are unwell, who are recovering from surgery, and others who have found the lockdown very difficult. We pray for each of them, and we pray for those who live alone especially. We thank you that we are now able to visit and be together and pray that you will prompt us to invite others to our homes or use other ways of gathering together. Father, we are grateful for those who have worked so hard in keeping our church family growing during this time. We pray for Tony and Mitchell, Nathan, for those who lead the services, those who mow the lawns, and Heather as she organises the bulletin each week. Thank you, Father, for all you do for us. May we show your love and compassion to each other and those we interact with each day. For we ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Anne. Peter, I'll hand things over to you.
Good morning, and thank you, Janet, for leading us in the theme of joy. I'm interested that fitted with you and your circumstances, your personality. Maybe people should consider which of the fruits of the Spirit they would like to lead the service because it really suits their personality. Peace, patience. There'd be a long queue for patience, wouldn't there? Yes, all those patient people. And there'll be somebody saying, I'll wait for self-control. I'll do that one. Thank you very much. Our God is an awesome God. Love that song. Thank you so much for that. And my wife and I had the same thought. I wonder how old Michael W. Smith is now. He was, to me, in my mind, he's this young man, this contemporary music maker. So I did a quick check. He's 64 years old. He's probably got a walking frame by now. Michael W. Smith, but love his music. Grew up with it. Still love it. Joy. We had a large youth group at church when I was young. And one of the girls, not unattractive, was named Joy, which made me smile when in the evening service we would sing the song that begins, "You shall go out with joy." I didn't go out with joy. I went out with Michelle, which is a far, far better thing that I have done. We're reflecting on the fruit of the Spirit listed in Galatians chapter 5, and yes, love, joy, we're up to joy, which I guess causes us to pause and ask, even just thinking of Anne's prayer, is this the best time to be talking about joy? With nearly 18 million current COVID cases in the world, nearly 5 million deaths, millions unemployed as a result, a recession facing the world beyond anything we've seen in our lifetime. Yeah, we do actually need to talk about joy. I want to begin by suggesting three scenarios where joy is possible. The first one is where present circumstances are delightful and welcome and heartwarming. The joy in the now, something in your circumstances, your life in the now is enfolding you in joy. You welcome your firstborn or something like that. Joy in the now. Secondly, a second scenario is where the present circumstances are difficult and painful and unpleasant, but they promise to open out into that delightful space. So a joy founded on hope, the joy of anticipation. Don't tell anybody, but my wife has wrapped all the Christmas presents. She has the joy of anticipation when it comes to Christmas. Now that's a second scenario, the joy founded on hope or the joy of anticipation. And the third scenario, again, is where present circumstances are difficult, maybe even a real trial, and yet the consequences are that another, perhaps someone we love, will benefit. So this scenario is the joy of blessing another. So the joy in the now, the joy founded on hope, the joy of blessing another. Let me invite you to expand that a bit in your mind. Let's go back to that first one, the joy in the now. What comes to your mind, the joy in the now? Maybe exam results exceed expectations. That's joyful. Never experienced that, but I'm sure it's joyful. Or as I said, that firstborn arrives and you bring them home to that carefully prepared nursery. That's a great joy. It's almost matched by the moment when that firstborn grows up and finally leaves home. What a joy that is. If we go to scripture, we can't go past the joy of the news that Jesus was risen. Remember the account of the two crestfallen disciples who were heading out of Jerusalem on the Emmaus Road, joined by a stranger. And as the conversation ensued and continued over a meal that evening, Jesus opened their eyes to his identity. They are in the presence of the risen Christ. And before they can press him further, he's gone. And they rush back to Jerusalem, literally it says within the hour. And they find the 11. It's true. And while the group is digesting the information, suddenly Jesus himself is standing among them. At first, they think maybe he's a ghostly figure. They're startled. They're afraid. And gently, Jesus commences a conversation. He invites them to touch him. His body is substantial, is real. It's not smoke and mirrors. And he brings them back to earth by asking, are there any leftovers to eat? It says in Luke 24, they disbelieved for joy. They still could not believe it through sheer joy. Their hearts must have been pounding and their minds were racing. The sheer joy of knowing that all you had entrusted yourself to, it's true. The sheer joy of knowing that every word that had been uttered by Jesus was being fulfilled. No enemy was going to deflect him from the purpose of the Father. That's joy in the now. Read those passages. If you can get into the step of the joy in the now. Scenario two was joy founded on hope, anticipation. I once played a part in a musical. We did the musical at school, Oklahoma. I don't know if any of you did that musical. I was Judd because I didn't have a great singing voice. I got to sing, oh, Judd is dead. It's a catchy tune, I know. The lead singer, Curly, he gets to sing, oh, what a beautiful morning. Oh, what a beautiful day. I've got a wonderful feeling. That's right. Everything is going my way, which I guess takes us back to scenario one. I can identify with that. When everything is going my way, it feels good. But I guess where we are at the moment in our world, it's more scenario two. We are called to endure difficult circumstances with the promise that they will open out into a spacious place of delight and of exuberant joy. And this scenario we find very often in Scripture. We rejoice in the hope of the glory of God, Romans 5:2. Joy founded on hope. It's been said that a person can live 40 days without food, 3 days without water, 8 minutes without air, not one minute without hope. Romans 12:12, be joyful in hope. Maybe there's something going through your mind at the moment, an example of the joy of anticipation. Maybe it's simply the fact that we're going to be able to see each other next Sunday. That's going to be delightful. There's a challenging picture described in Hebrews chapter 10. You've probably heard these words before. Let me read these few verses to you. It's in Hebrews 10 from about verse 33. And the writer says this: sometimes you were publicly exposed to insult and persecution. At other times you stood side by side with those who were so treated. You suffered along with those in prison and joyfully accepted the confiscation of your property because you knew that you yourselves had better and lasting possessions. But don't throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. Joyfully accepted the confiscation of your property. So that second scenario is joy founded on hope. And I want to suggest it's possible because of two very important, very foundational truths. The first is this: God has a purpose. Yeah, I can be fairly confident that everybody who's listening to me knows what it's like to be in the valley. And we know those words of Paul in Romans 5, we rejoice in our sufferings. What's he saying? He's not saying that hardships are enjoyable, but rather we rejoice because God has a purpose. What we face in life, even the hardships of life, are for the believer productive of character, of perseverance, of hope. Romans 5:3-5, we have joy with our troubles because we know these troubles produce patience, and patience produces character, and character produces hope, and this hope will never disappoint us because God has poured out his love to fill our hearts, his love through the Holy Spirit. There's a few other fruits of the Spirit in those verses. And of course, sure, there are times when by faith we say, I don't understand, I don't enjoy what I'm called to face. But believing that God will work out his good purpose in and through it, I will not be robbed of the joy he has placed in my heart. God has a purpose. The other foundational truth is that he is with us. Still in Romans 5, Paul says, we rejoice because of what God has done through our Lord Jesus Christ, who has now made us God's friends. Words of reconciliation. He is with us. You know, joy is under threat if we feel deserted, if we feel abandoned, if you've ever felt that. But it's a lonely place, and joy disappears. These words you know well. You probably sung them in Isaiah 43. When you pass through deep waters, I will be with you. Your troubles will not overwhelm you. When you pass through fire, you will not be burned. He is with us. So that's scenario two, the joy of anticipation. You've forgotten what the third one is already. I have too. That's why I've got it written down. The joy of blessing another. Okay, this is about having the faith that perhaps even as a consequence of what I'm struggling through, another will benefit. Another will be blessed. I was chatting with a friend from Batemans Bay. We ministered down there some years back, and we were interested when the fires went through the south coast. And I was talking with this friend from Batemans Bay. She was in the church down there, and she described how during that bushfire catastrophe on the south coast, she stood preparing food all day until her legs and feet were crying out for rest, screaming out for rest. And yet I sensed she wouldn't hesitate to do it all again. Many of you know the joy of blessing another at cost to yourself. These words again from Hebrews chapter 12, you'll know them. Let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross. I dare to believe that the joy set before Christ as he endured the cross was not only the joy of doing the Father's will, not only the joy of anticipated reunion with the Father, but also the joy of bringing into glory those whom he would call brothers and sisters, those of whom he says, I'm not ashamed. He's talking about us. Now, you're all sitting there with the mute button on, and some of you are thinking, yeah, preacher, you don't know what my life is like. Overwhelmed with stress, uncertainty, and demands. Well, let me share a story with you. It comes from a book by Jim Cimbala. If you've ever read any of his books, so if you haven't, I commend them to you. This one's from a book called Fresh Power, Jim Cimbala. Think of symbol with an A on the end of it. And he writes of one of the soloists in his choir at Brooklyn Tabernacle. Her name is Robin Giles. She's a woman of sincere and gracious spirit. And yes, the fruits of peace and kindness and gentleness are especially evident in her life, which is truly amazing given the vicious atmosphere in which she grew up in Cleveland. From birth, she was hated by her mother. A mother, an unmarried 21-year-old stuck with this unwanted daughter. Robin says, I grew up in a house of fear. From early years, I was slapped about, I was beaten. I never remember a single hug or a kiss. The words I heard most were, you're stupid. Everything you touch, you mess up. I wish you were dead. That was her mother speaking. Robin says, on one occasion, she took refuge in a cupboard to escape her mother's rage, but didn't reach it soon enough and was scalded on her arm with a hot pancake iron her mother wielded as a weapon. See what you made me do, was all her mother would say as she wrapped the wound in gauze. When her mother found Robin sitting and talking with the boy on the porch one summer night, she took to her with a doubled up electric cord until welts and gashes bled from Robin's arm. The story goes on, including an undeserved 3 months in juvenile detention. What would you expect a young person like that to become? Well, there are drug dealers out there, there are pimps who spot these types at once, and they become the victims of such predators. And for 11 years, Robin traveled a rough road of self-doubt and depression, of inner seething at the unfairness of life, you can understand that, irresponsible relationships, even a suicide attempt. But God had redemptive plans for Robin. Following the acceptance of a friend's invitation, she found herself at church and finally at Brooklyn Tabernacle. And today, she is a walking example of Jesus' ability to set the captive free, to heal the brokenhearted. Robin says, God has taken the sting out of my past. For so long, the memories of my mother's behavior kept me from experiencing abundant life. And then I realized the Lord had changed my heart towards her. I had hated her for so long, and God totally took that away. It's true. The Holy Spirit has the power to diffuse the most raging resentment. He brings his power into the most troubled lives and produces something beautiful. And he brings joy. The Lord has given me freedom from my past. I am so thankful, declared Robin as she shared her testimony. And so God declares to us, we've heard this sung, we've echoed it this morning, the joy of the Lord is your strength. To walk in joylessness and despondency is by definition to forfeit our strength and vitality. Jesus came among us, he became one of us. He knows from his own human experience on earth that trials, temptations exert a tremendous downward pull on our souls, and he is faithful. The Holy Spirit has been sent to lift up our heads, no matter the circumstances, and fulfill the words of the prophet. Gladness and joy will overtake them. Sorrow and sighing will flee away. And so my question to you this morning is, how's your joy? Let me pray for you. Let me pray for us. Lord, we thank you for this fruit as your Spirit dwells within us, the fruit of joy. We know, as we've just reflected, that sometimes that joy can be under threat. And we know that when that joy is under threat, when that joy departs us, then our strength in you wanes and weakens. Lord, continue to grow this fruit in our lives, the joy of the Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you redeem us. Thank you, Lord, that you are able to take the sting of past hurts and disappointments from our lives and to fill us with your presence and with your love and with your joy. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Peter. Yes, we have truly focused on joy, and I hope that people can really come to terms with going back to some of those readings that Peter gave us during the week and focus on how that we can have joy in our lives. He gives it to us.